Hello and welcome to Dell's Gaming. I'm Dell and this is From the Depths Designer. And in this episode we are looking at or continuing on our how-tos, and we will be looking at aircraft propulsion and basically getting them to fly in this episode. Now, first of all, this isn't an in-depth how to do every little item on a plane. So they're quite a large subject on their own, and there's some people out there which are I'm sure are better than I am at this type of thing. But this is some bits that I go through and what I have found when taking into account and getting aircraft to fly initially and then tweaking them later on. So first of all, the key bit is build your body first, because without the body, sorting out how the wings, propulsion, etc. is going to work, you're going to have to change them around later. So try and get what you can done of your vehicle straight away. Now, I've created a small little vehicle here, and the design of a vehicle is up to yourself. How the body will look is purely down to your own imagination. The actual body itself doesn't provide any lift as such. The shape of the design does have an effect with drag, so a more thin sloped design like we have here is going to go faster than a very blocky design, which is basically a big box. But you can make a big box fly if that's what you so desire. Other elements is materials. There's a lot of materials you can use to build. This has all been made with alloy, light metal alloy, which is the, I suppose in so many ways, is a preferred material. The lightweight alloy is, as the name suggests, lightweight. That's a big key, because obviously another one is the lighter the vehicle, the faster it will fly, the easier it will be to lift, and generally, you know, it ends up as a quicker plane. But it's very expensive. It has a reasonable armor value and reasonable health. You can quite happily build your ship or your aircraft body in wood. Wood is heavier than light alloy, doesn't have the armor value, but has a reasonable health, not as much, but it is a lot cheaper on resources early on in the game if you're doing the campaign than using light alloy. It also floats. The light alloy here, you can see, is floating quite happily. I'm not having to use any pumps or any other types of buoyancy. It is buoyant on its own, so that is of a great benefit. You can do this out of metal. Metal obviously is the heaviest metal, but it is the most resilient. So obviously it has the highest armor value and the highest health, but you've got a heavy plane. So it's a matter of balancing these. You can also mix and match. If you've got your vulnerable areas, you could cover them in metal and do the rest in light alloy with some maybe some wood in places, just to where it's not required to be light or to balance things up. So you can mix your materials. So what else will you need? Well, I've got something. I'm just going to raise this out of the water so it's easier to see and we're not bobbing around all over the place. Now, you can, you'll need an engine, of course. Now, I've put a simple engine in here. I'll just use the P here. So we've exploded the vehicle designer by pressing the P button. So you can see there is an engine inside, and I've put a little bomb bay down there, nothing flash, just some missiles in there. So we now want to be able to control this. There's a number of things we need to do. First of all, to gain control of this, you can drive this manually by fitting the vehicle control, which is under E, control, vehicle control, and you can put that in front of your character and you can manually control it. Now you'll now notice, just get off of this for a second, and you'll notice up on the top left hand corner we've got a number of buttons that can be used to control this vehicle whilst we're in air mode. If you go out of air mode for some reason, you can see I've changed it to water mode by pressing the Q key. Now obviously we don't want to be in land, we want to be in air mode to be able to control this vehicle. And as we add control elements to this vehicle, you'll see that the buttons at the top left will change and give us abilities to be able to control thrust. So we'll start with a jet engine, because obviously no matter what we do, we want to go forward. We're not looking at rotorcraft in this one. This is aimed mainly at jet powered. You could do the same with a propeller, but we're going to stick to jets for the moment in this particular episode. So you can just whack loads of engines on the rear, and you'll see that the T and G at the top have now become available to be able to increase the speed. If I increase, press T, you'll notice that the air drive on the right hand side has increased to a level of 5, and I can then press the opposite way, G, and it goes all the way down to 0 again. Now placing engines haphazardly on your vehicle has a connotation, there is good and bad reasons to do this. The most important part about your aircraft that's going to be important for all aspects of control is the center of mass. Very similar to the aircraft, if we press the P button, you'll notice we have our center of mass just here between two blocks, which is a little unfortunate. So just about this point here. So we want to make sure that all of our thrust is kept within those two points. Now this isn't gonna fly very well at this moment. Obviously we have no other lifting, but it goes fairly straight. If I was to put all of the thrust below at the center of mass, you'll notice we just do a nice big wheelie and the reverse would be true. So if we put them all at the top, or we put too many at the top at least anyway, and we press the button, we're just going to go straight into the sea. So we need to balance them. Now there's two ways to balance it. You can put it exactly on the level, but the main bit is it balances up with all of the thrust. So putting these two opposite so they're equidistant from the center of mass allows it to go forward. It's got a slight downward there, but we have no other lift at this moment. Now I'm gonna go to a slightly more closer design by putting these nice and close to the center of mass, but we could let me just solve that there. Likewise, you want to keep symmetrical with your design. I'm going to put my mirror line on now. So if you place one to the side, you want to make sure it is placed to the side on the other side as well. If we take off the mirror line, if we just test that now, you'll notice, yeah, no problems really, that's going still relatively straight. If I was to take off one side, we're just going to end up with a big spinner. There we go, could be useful at times. At this moment, not what we're after. So I'm going to stick with a small engine for this moment, because I don't need anything too grand. So we've got some forward thrust now. Now we need to be able to force our vehicle up. We want to be able to make it go upwards. Now, there is a number of items you would need, or ways of doing this. The first item that gives you control is under air, you have the tailplane. Now the tailplane actually acts in two axes at the same time. It's actually a rudder and also a tailplane at the same a rudder and elevators combined in one. These are not separated in this particular design. Now again, you will want to stick with your center point and be equidistant. So we're just going to do a nice simple design here, putting them in that type of area. Now you'll notice that we've got four more buttons have come up: U, J, Y, and I. So to go up, I just hold the J button, and what I'm now going to do is press down on the bottom left hand side. You'll see down at the bottom it says tap slash to see all forces. So now you can see all the forces being applied on this craft, and this is very handy to work out where your actual thrust is going to be going. So if I now press my T button, you can see the yellow line, that's the force from the engines, and the blue line is actually where we're going to end up going. If I now press J, let's see if we can see these here, and it's not showing me those particular ones at this time. Let's just take it off of here. There we go. If I press J, can you see the purple line, which is showing my use of the J button? So that is giving force. So we've got this now going up, but I'm having to basically, if I let go of this, it will, that's holding there quite nicely. I've managed to balance it, which is unintended, but if I get it off, it's not got a natural lifting body on this here. But that's given us those forces. And also, if I use the I and Y key, they give us yaw, which is the same as a rudder. So if I do the same again, if I go there, you can see the orange line and you can see how we are moving to the side. Once again, center of mass is very important. If we follow the, if you just see them, these as rudders, and decide, oh, okay, well, we'll follow the standard convention of an aircraft and we'll just create a nice big rudder at the back. There we go. Seen on all planes, a nice rudder. Now, when we take this off here, we've still got up and down control, which is fine. But when I use my yaw control, you see how the whole ship turns at the same time. So we've now got a roll problem at the same time. So that is in adding a control issue that you don't really want. So it is better to keep your controls. There may be a reason, before I go any further, there may be a reason in your design why you want to be able to do a roll at the same time. But, you know, it's very rare, and also it's going to be difficult for the computer in the AI control to be able to manage that. It's better to have actual proper roll controls for when you want to roll. So now with this stabilized again, we can now, when we turn, we stay relatively flat. This has got a slight bit of lift there, which you could take out just by balancing up and working out what, there we go, it's a little bit of roll in the reverse area. Just by balancing out those controls, you can get a relatively stable yaw. There we go, that's relatively stable, just slightly the other way. Slightly down and the other way, but nothing too bad. So that's fairly stable. A good yaw control without any excessive roll. Now, talking of roll, the next little item we have is the aileron. Now, the aileron is basically to control a role specifically, rather than the elevator and tailplane, which is for yaw and your up and down motion. Now look, we can use these. I know the center of gravity is just there because there's a nice line there. We can just check that. There we go. That's the position from the center of mass. We want to be close to this center of mass. Now, the more elevators you have, or sorry, ailerons you have, the more roll control you will receive. So if we just put one on there, now you'll notice that we've got K and H have become available. We've got some roll. It's a little sluggish, but it's not too bad. If I add some more in, and try that one more time, yes, that turns a lot quicker. So you would want a few. You depend on what type of vehicle you want to be able to design. You can either create a very stable vehicle, or you can create something which is very unstable, a squirrel or sneak, etc., to evade the enemy. Now, to be honest, manually flying such a ship, this has hardly got any controls, but it's feasible by just following these center point and staying with the center of mass to be able to control this vehicle. We're nearly in the water, nearly in the water. Okay. So it is possible, but we now want to be able to run this with the AI rather than myself manually. So I'm taking off the engines, so I won't be trying to force it to do anything. And now we want to give this a bit of AI control. So first thing we're going to need is a mainframe. So if we've got a little space here, so we'll put it into this space back here, and we add an AI mainframe. And then, similar to the naval vessel, we'll need a left and right card slot, which, as we explained, depends on which way the cards will go. So this left and right slot allows cards to be put into the left and right, an up and down, a front and back. If I put one of those in there, it would allow cards to be put in these two positions instead. Now, cards, again, as we discussed previously, are equivalent to programs. So we can put an AI card in here, and this is an aerial card. And that now has allowed this to control the vessel it is a part of. Now, we will also add into this a wireless transmitter so that our weapons will work. Because the Bombay needs the AI here as well. So let's go and have a quick look at some of the controls that this AI will use to fly this plane. Okay, so starting at the top, this is the default menu as we have here. So some of these, the default settings, tend to need a little bit of tweaking at least, but they're a good starting point for most ships, and then you can tweak them from that point. Now, there is a tooltip as you move over these, and you know, please read them because they make perfect good sense and they're easier than me repeating things. But to go through, quite simply, angle deviation. This is where generally the ship will turn using your control, so using the rudder, the tailplanes, in the rudder configuration, so your control. So it will just try and stay flat and just turn left and right using that type of control. Now, what you can do is by setting this as a small value, you make it very accurate and try and fly over the target. Basically, it will try and do its best, but it will get very wobbly because it will be constantly trying to adjust. It won't just sort of say, oh, that's close enough. The larger this value goes means it will wait before turning until it is over that value, and then it will turn towards it and then if it starts veering off, it's going to wait until it gets to that value again. So you'll find you're going slightly larger, almost curves towards it. If you set this to a very high value, obviously you can't be too high, but you could theoretically set it at a very high value. Now that means it would turn all the way one way and then almost be heading away, then turn back in the opposite direction, and that would give it a very lazy turning circle. Could be good also if you want to, don't want something getting too close, you're not worried about closeness. You want it to constantly being going from left and right, almost like a broadside style of vessel. In this case we're going to go for fairly close. I'll go for about 10 degrees. We'll leave it at the standard. Now roll is where the AI will use the ailerons to roll the vehicle to make it head towards the target position. Again, you can make this small or large. It depends how good your vehicle is at with the rudder and your control. The more tailplanes you give your vehicle, the more quickly it will be able to turn towards the target. So, you know, you might be able to set this value and not have roll very used very much. Your angle roll is generally will turn a little quicker because it will actually use roll and then use the tailplanes in the elevator configuration to turn towards the target. So that's like banking and then pulling back on the stick. The problem with having this too large, and in theory having a 180 means it would turn upside down and go backwards, so that doesn't really make sense. But this particular angle is at what point, sorry, that was my fault there, at what point it will start to use the roll and turn to turn towards the target rather than relying just on the yaw motion. And you might want to set this relatively high. You can set it 180. 180 means it will never use it. It will always only use the rudder style of turning. The other part of ailerons is the AI will always try and keep your ship level when not turning, rolling for a turn. So it will still use the ailerons at all times just to try and keep you level. Now in this configuration we'll set this at about 60 degrees just for an item. Right, the most extreme roll. Now the extreme roll is how much roll the AI will apply to your ship. Going too high, and basically you end up almost pointing downwards. So what that means is you will basically head towards the ground. When you are in most air vehicles, the basic parameters and build is to make it fly upwards to obviously get lift. When you turn to the side, you're making that lift you towards the side effectively. If you point that downwards, it will obviously lift you down towards the ground. Because you're turning, you're rolling, the amount of lift your vehicle has got is being reduced. So generally your vehicle will start to lose height in a roll. There's a number of ways of counteracting this, but you need to balance this. This is a balancing factor. If you've set your roll too low, you'll find that your ship will gain altitude when it's rolling. If you set it too high, you'll find that your vehicle will lose altitude in the turn. So you've got to find the value which is good for your vehicle. Now what we'll do is we'll start at a smaller value and then adjust it. It's better to be gaining altitude than crashing into the ground. Generally for planes that's a good idea. They're very good at taking off, not so good at on the landing, you know. Next two are relatively self-explanatory. Cruising altitude. Cruising altitude is the altitude that the vessel will try to keep when not on an attack run towards the target. So we're going to set this. It can go very high, which is to be used for space planes, but we want to keep this at a relatively low altitude. So we're going to set this at say 250. Let's set this at 150. 150 as an altitude that the AI will try and keep this aircraft. Minimum altitude. Now, minimum, as the name sort of suggests, is the altitude that the AI will try not to go below. When it reaches this minimum altitude, it will start to try and pull up again. And that is also in attack profile as well. So if it gets to that altitude, it will start to try and pull up again and get back up to a reasonable altitude. So so during its bomb run, or just in general, if you go below this figure, the AI will change all of its parameters to make its priority gain height. Okay, now we get to the attack run parts, which we'll go over a little bit here, but generally they're semi-self-explanatory. Now, the attack run is at, similar to like the broadside run we had before. At what range will your vessel start its attack run on the enemy vessel? Now, attack run means it will head towards it and go into a slightly diving profile, or head towards a target, depending on how you've done it, still keeping within the minimum altitude and roll type of level. Also, once it has executed its attack run, it will go out to this distance again to return for a second attack run. Now, the abort point is at what range do you want your vessel to say, okay, I have engaged my attack, abort the run, head out to the far distance and start the run again. Now, how you can use these depends on your ship profile. Some attack runs you want to have coming in from long distance, and they stay at long distance. That way you'd set both values fairly high. You'd try and keep a minimum distance. If you're more of a bomber style, you actually want to overfly the target like we have here. So we actually want to ensure that only when we're right over the target will our system say, okay, we've obviously got over the top of the target, so we're going to set that at 100. So it's now okay to go to our range, turn around and come back for a second attack run. If you were a fighter aircraft, which is more of a dogfighting aircraft, you might even want to set this really, really low. Kamikaze level, zero. It will keep on going until you crash in, or at a slightly more reasonable level of 25, which means you're right on the tail and you would have blasted the enemy to bits. And you might, so you can set these values depending on the attack profile you're looking for from your aircraft. At the elapsed time, again, well, I won't say again, is to do with once you've reached your abort point and are heading away, how long before you start to turn, just in case. If the other ship starts following you, it's possible you'll never actually get to your furthest point, especially if they're faster than you. So you might actually want to say, right, well, okay, well, let's start heading back towards them and try and attack them. So you might want this low for a dogfighter, and slightly higher for something which is fast and you want to ensure that it gets out to the long range before coming in. Okay, so that's the AI. And I've set those values, and we'll mostly have to come in here primarily maybe to just change the role once we have done a little bit of work. So, okay, we've got AI. Let's see how the AI does straight away with what we have set up already. So you can see, well, it's actually sort of managing to fly this. Because we have enough power and it's light enough, this will fly purely on the power of the thrust. And you'll note it's going to be using the roll ailerons and the rudders, the tail planes, to keep its height. But it's going a little high. It's not managing the height very well at all. Let's just see what we're in. We'll just stay on combat mode. So it's not really managing the height very well. Okay, we're just basically... It has also possibly one other problem, which can be managed in a couple of ways. So it had a tendency to go up. So I'm just going to take off those two. So I think they possibly wasn't liking those. So immediately, this has made my job a lot easier because I've got more thrust than I have weight here. So it's flying without too much of a problem, to be frankly honest, which is easier with fast planes than heavy planes. So let me just get this into the water. But one problem we're going to have here, I'm sort of semi-predicting, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to artificially set down these engines. I'm going to set these down to half speed. So we haven't got as much power now. So I've just set those engines to half power. Now we're in the water. This is a whole different issue. When you're in the water and you need to get out, A, your engines don't work as well unless you can get a nice big jump out of the water. So there's a couple of ways we can go out. But first of all, what we're going to do, we're just going to see if we can make this lift off again with this lower power. So if I just bring it out of the water, has this now, it has still just enough power to get up. So okay, let's take the power down a little bit more. Let's see if we can get this so it doesn't fly. You can see it's flying, but that's a very nose up attitude and it is actually losing height. So what we now need to do is give it some more lift. So this would be equivalent to a vessel which needs a bit of help with flying. Now I think that might be a little bit too low. We'll go to a 20% I think on power. There we go. So still nose heavy, but at least we're getting a little bit of speed. So what is on the next block we can use? Right, we now have the wing. The wing generates lift, quite simply, like a real wing. Now, general convention, again, it is all around the center point. But you do have to balance this. Generally, you'd want this to be slightly behind the center point, but not by much. If we we do a very poor wing at the moment, and you can get as quite artistic or with your wing design. Now this is going to be effectively very centralized. And see, actually, that's still bringing up the front quite a bit. So what we do is we start balancing the wing loading to get a more symmetrical flight pattern, or slightly, there we go. You can see that's leveling off. It's managing it within reason. So that's not too bad for this speed. Obviously a very poor design of wing. There we go, that's a little bit level. It's going up occasionally because we don't have enough power here really to make this fly. We are a little low on power. We are making it fly just. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to chop this wing off. Under up the power, because the idea, I've shown you the basic of there. Let's take this power up again. Because I like a fast ship. Right, so it's still got a fairly nose-up attitude. So we're going to try and balance that off. And we're going to try and keep some of this speed on this here. So what I'm doing is I'm making a slight delta. You don't have to do a delta wing here. It can be just lots of lifting. I'm keeping to the center of, close as I can to the center of the mass of the vehicle. And there we've got, we're keeping our altitude fairly well, slightly up on occasion. It's just gained up there a little. And we're just balancing off those ailerons. That's quite good. I think that's not too bad at all. Now we also have, let's just get us heading back towards our start point. So that actually wasn't too bad a turn. It just executed there. That's not too bad. It gained a bit of height in that turn. But you can see that's a fairly level flight. So what would happen if we decided, oh, I didn't want this type of configuration. I've obviously done a very typical design, balancing that off there, which is the easiest to do and my suggestion. And do little bits at a time, like we did there, not try and put too much all in one place. So just to show how this does actually affect it, if we were to just put, for some reason we decided we want a real big canard style design, and we've decided that this is going to be the plan for us, and because this is what it needs in design, and that's how we've decided it should look. It's not getting enough lift. You can see it's going straight into the ground. It's really trying as best it can on the tail here to try and get it to lift, but it's not having it. So that's because all of the lift was at the rear of the center of mass. Same, let's try. We want forward canards. Canards at the front. We've seen those on planes. And I'm sure they're supposed to be good or something, aren't they? You know, so we put lots of canards at the front to help our craft. So now you can see at the back, it's struggling to try and actually get it to go nose down. Now, it's trying and not really succeeding. I'm going to put it on combat mode. It goes up very well, but it's having a problem trying to get the nose down. We'll just keep on climbing and climbing. Now, theoretically, you could mix these two. If we start adding a bit on the rear here. Something like that. We'll see. We're still a little bit heavy on the rear by the looks of that there. So we're just balancing it off using the mirror line. So there we go. We have actually got both sides. So you can balance this off to based on the center to get that the desired nice level. We're flying fairly level with that. That's okay. That's not too bad. It's a slightly different design, so you can go for the very centrally located. The other way you can affect this is with weight. You can get some, say, metal blocks or a lead block and put it at the front and back and actually move the center of balance around. Other things you can do here is the position of your wing. Doesn't necessarily have to follow normal convention. If I just do that there, there's nothing to say that you can't. It has to be in the center. It's only all a matter of balancing out all of the forces. that you're applying to the vehicle. And you can come up with any sort of design you wish. One other good point on it, there's no structural limitations on the aircraft. Things aren't going to break off if you go too fast. That's lifting a little bit too much on the rear. Yep, didn't like that. It was a little too much, I think, on the back there. There we go. So, yep, we can. Still a little bit too much. So, basically, balancing. We're just applying some lift, little bit at a time, until we get a relatively stable platform, and then you just tweak it a little bit. You can see it's it doesn't like this. It's possible, but it's not very stable. But if this is the design that you have your heart set on, it is possible to, with enough balancing, to get it to fly and then work it into your design later. So it's feasible. Yes. So basically you can make these work. You can force it as well by putting more control in with the tailplanes, as an example. What we can do is give them more force to be able to force this design to fly. So it's all a matter of balancing. You can see that's actually, despite this very weird design we've got now with the wings, looks ugly as heck, but you know, it works if that was what you'd got your heart set on looking like, for, because you're even weirder than me, if that's possible. Then this is how you could end up. Let's put a couple more down there. So I have a double biplane front canard. There you go. It's sort of flying, but that's not very stable. Okay, one other bit, stability. And we're just gonna see how this turns. So we can see in our turn, actually, that's not too bad. That was quite a good little turn at that particular degrees. What we'll muck around with, just to see how this works, is we're going to change this roll, but we're going to make the roll extreme roll. We're going to make it to 25 degrees, so it won't do a very big roll at all. Let's gain some height. In fleet move, it's at the moment, I think it's set to go fairly low, so let's gain some height. There we go. It's trying in our little unstable design. I was saying about stability and turning. There's advantages of being unstable. I did say about it, in that when you're being attacked, if you're unstable, it's more difficult for cannon arms and missiles to hit you. If you're ultimately very stable, it's very easy for them to hit you. So there is advantages of being unstable. The downside is, if you're unstable, it's very difficult for your own weapons to hit the enemy, because they're constantly having to adjust, and you may not get an opportunity to fire, especially for things like cannon-armed vessels. So, you know, you need to balance off your stability with instability. Right, let's just try get a turn here. Oops, let's possibly... In fact, let's put it into combat mode. Let's manually turn this. So let's give it a big bit of yaw, just to put it totally out of control. There we go. Let the AI take it back. There we go. See, it's quite good at regaining control of this aircraft, which is good. and then we'll try the fleet move again. So this is a very limited, you can see it did not like, there's something about that 25 degrees, it did not like that on that particular turn value. It turned nicely before, and then that time it did not like it at all. So we'll put that down back to 45, which was a nice turn value for this particular ship. And that's just one of those things you're going to have to play with. It's not always going to work. Yeah, that's reasonable. It likes 45 degrees. It's not 100% good turn, but it likes a 45 degrees. Okay. Just to show what it actually does in the attack profile, so I've just given it a vanguard out there now to just put it into combat mode. So it will now head towards the target. You can see it's heading towards the target. It's gaining a little bit of altitude. And then at the particular range, you can see that the Vanguard is having problems looking into this because it is somewhat erratic. But it's now going to have reached its range somewhere about now. It's going to be coming down, and there it's dropping its little bomb load that we'd devised for this. And at the right range, it would have said, right, abort. And now it's going to just basically head out to the 550-meter mark, approximately, which is about there, and you can see it should start turning. It's now going to be turning around to try and go back for another run on the craft. It's obviously having a bit of a problem turn with this turn in this case, so I think we need to give it a little bit more angle on the turn. It needs more than that 45 degrees. So where's that? So let's take it up to 55 degrees. See if that gives it a bit better turn. I think it might need a little bit more than that. So this is a balancing factor. We're just balancing all of the turning to get a good turn, so it turns without losing. At the moment, it's still gaining altitude in its turn. It actually gains altitude. Let's put this quite high. So you can go from one extreme to the other. I think we're actually almost gone into space here, so we need to just give this a chance to resettle down. Runway is putting into fleet mode there. Put it into combat mode. Let's see if it will go in. So, okay, I think I've shown the basics of balancing and flight model. What you need to do, again, similar to the naval, you have to keep an eye on the center of mass and balance it all around. If you make a big change to your vehicle, you are going to have to rebalance all of your wings and your ailerons and all of the rest of it to fit in with the changes to make sure it works. But that's what makes aircraft... Oh, it's got a nice turn now. That's a good level of turn. That's not bad at all. Yeah, like that. That was good. So it was actually 85 was a good value. That's turned nice and quickly. And we're dropping again. Excellent. I like it when a plan comes together all in one shot. And this is I actually quite like that wing design. It's like a mini Klingon bird of prey type of thing. Yeah, that's interesting. Okay, I'm sure there is better people out there at designing planes than I am, and I'm sure there's some bits I have missed on this. This is not a thruster-based design or rotor. Thruster-based design is where it uses engines to stay aloft, using the power of the engines. And rotor designs use rotors to obviously gain the lift rather than wings, which would be a different... we'll do that in a separate how-to, specifically on rotors and how rotors work, because this one's gone on long enough now. But hopefully this has been helpful to people who are trying to build aircraft. or at least want to know how it is done. If you've got any questions, please leave them in the comments below, or anything else you specifically you would like to see, please leave them in the comments. Please click that like just to let me know you're watching the video. But until next time, please keep doing those mad ass designs I see in the Steam and on the forums, etc., because some people have got some very good ideas at how to design, and much better than me, and it makes me feel a little bit inadequate sometimes, and you've got to keep those feelings going. But until next time, keep playing, keep building, and have fun.